here. There we go. It's hi there. Hi everybody. How are you? I'm just checking in here. And let me do a few things here first to get things rolling. I have to take this and damn it. Come here, you. There's a little picture I have to. Don't do that because I can't. It's a very tender thing I have to do.
What's that green thing?
Huh? Don't worry about that.
I'm just asking.
The green thing is where the Skype picture is.
Oh.
There we go. Let me move that over to here. Hi, folks. How are you?
Call in.
Yeah.
Can you move this over?
What?
Move the
microphone
over.
No, that's fine. That's fine. No. Be good now. Now let me turn on my Skype so that we can talk with you. Okay. And in case people haven't called before, we use Skype here. And Skype's very simple to use. You just simply go to Skype, download Skype from Skype.com. First name, last name, what do you call it? What's the word I'm looking
handle?
For? A password and a handle. And you're in, you know. And the first guy up here tonight is,
what do you
I
call
believe,
it?
is.
No, a password and a handle.
What are you doing? Phil.
Me?
Yeah.
I was turning off the live feed.
Yeah.
You didn't put live stream on.
Huh? Live stream is on.
Oh.
What do you think this is?
This is Skype.
We got live stream. You see, add to group. Jason is calling. And Rob Alfano is calling. Hello, Jason. Hello, Rob. How are you?
Hi.
So, Phil, I thought you weren't going to be here tonight.
I said Thursday. I said probably Friday, but...
Why are we only seeing half your face?
I got to adjust the camera. There's something wrong with it.
Wow.
Yeah. So, let me get it in there.
Yeah, because it is TV night. Hi, Jason.
Why don't you just roll your chair?
No, I think he's got his digital Zoom.
Yeah.
Yeah, he keeps fooling with that Zoom, and it drives us nuts. There you go. Just leave it there. Go back to that and just leave it there. There. That's fine. Okay.
Well, it wasn't working the other day. I don't know why.
All right, well,
but,
don't experiment here on the air. We have a show to do. Just leave it like that and you're fine.
All right.
Okay. Don't touch anything. So anyway, you weren't here last night. It was a great show.
Yeah, I listened to it.
It was a terrific show. Rob, you seem to agree with that.
No, I was laughing the way you said that.
You weren't here, so it was great.
I wasn't here, so it was great. No, it was. They've been very good the last several nights.
Yeah.
You're more in control, and the people that are calling are.
Well, I had a problem last night, so I didn't get on until about an hour in. And
yeah.
I find that when I do an hour show, they're always terrific. You know?
You know, you might not be tired.
No, you know what it is? And I've said this before.
Yeah.
If I have to do a three-hour show, like I do sometimes on radio, then you measure yourself. You've only got so much in you. You measure yourself out over those 3 hours. Now if it's just, and Rob knows this, if it's a two-hour show, then you measure yourself out over, parcel yourself out the same amount over 2 hours. You've got 1 hour, you're kicking ass because you don't have to parcel yourself out but for 1 hour.
You're in full sprint.
Am I right, Rob?
Yeah, it also works that way if you're a pitcher. If you're a relief pitcher, you get it all out there in one inning because you know you're only going to pitch to three or four batters. If you got to pitch 7-8 innings, you got to parse yourself out.
Yeah,
same way with the sprinter.
Yeah, you've only got so much in you.
That's right.
So you used to do 4 hours.
Well, yeah, but...
No,
Camel 6 to 10.
Let's see. What was I at Sirius? Was that? Four
I don't know. I can listen to you. There.
Three hours on Sirius.
Hours. Yeah, but
that was 9 to 12 originally.
Yeah, I did 4
right?
hours when I was younger.
Yeah, 6 to 10. Because you used to pick me up in the morning when I was helping you.
Yeah.
At 4:30. And
there were also a lot of breaks for music during that.
Yeah, right,
so
exactly.
So therefore, it was easy to do 4 hours that way.
Yeah.
I mean, I could do 4 hours here every night if I were playing music and with the discussions and stuff. Of course, that wouldn't work.
You were also spinning the discs and pushing in the carts and doing all your own board work. The only thing anybody ever did for you, if you didn't do it yourself, was screen the calls.
Really?
Yeah. So yeah, you were a real firebrand there.
It was a real firebrand.
Yeah. You know, one thing you can't do on this that I do miss from Sirius was Friday Quickies. Yeah. I love that, man. That was so awesome.
Yeah, Quickies was something that I can't do it here. I could, you know, I could try, but it wouldn't work. It really wouldn't work.
It wouldn't work.
You know, we don't have the same kind of phone setup. And even there, you know, Quickies was dependent on the fact that I had enough people calling to do Quickies. But thank God after a while, people were waiting for it every Friday, so the only time they would ever call the show is when we were doing Quickies.
Was it tough to get calls at Sirius?
No.
Some days. Some days. I mean, you know, you think that we have problems here. I've got three people right now. Probably as the show goes on, we'll probably get about six people here eventually throughout the night, besides myself.
See, I never count.
You have to compare that to the fact that I, for instance, worked at WOR doing a show that went out nationally and sitting there with empty phone lines.
That's crazy.
Wow.
You know, you would think that they would just all light up, but they don't. You know, I asked Albert, he used to work with Limbaugh over at WABC.
Yeah.
Then he said even Limbaugh would sit there some days with the phones not ringing.
I worked at a music station on Long Island, the number one station, but the phones never stopped ringing.
That was a bill collector.
Take calls. Yeah, bill collectors. And we didn't even really take calls except for contests, and those phones never stopped ringing.
Will you play this song? Will you dedicate it to this person? Yeah,
absolutely. That's what it was all, you know, play this, play that, play this.
I remember being a teenager, there was, at our Light Rock channel, there was a love line.
Well, here was
a show like that.
But here was the great lie about stations that took requests, and Rob will agree with me on this. Will you play such and such? Sure. Stay tuned. We'll get to it as soon as we can. We have some other requests first to take care of. And eventually, you're going to play that song anyway.
A lot of times we would say they call and they want to hear a song and you say, hey, I got an idea. How about, you know, say you want to hear this.
Yeah.
Okay. And then they say they want to hear that. And it's the song I have to play.
But they want a dedication.
Yeah. So you do a dedication as long as you're playing the song that you're supposed to play.
Yeah.
It's all, you know, it's
Alex invented the line, I don't take no requests. But the reason he did it was because he didn't want to play any of the new music, I believe.
No, I came up with that because I just didn't like the idea of requests.
Yeah, you know, but
because I knew damn well that I had a list of what I was supposed to play for those four hours in order. And even if somebody called up to request it, it was luck of the draw if they got it.
Well, it was color-coded. Or at least when I helped you, it was color-coded.
Yeah, but that doesn't matter. All I'm saying is that if I took requests, I wasn't going to honor them anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like taking requests because it was the only time I could have any fun, really. You could be a little creative with the callers, and you could cut down the calls and make it cool, and otherwise,
Alex would hang up on them.
Boring.
When people would request something, or I would say, oh, by the way, here we go. Jeff Stein's calling again. Hi, Jeff. Good to have you on again tonight.
Hi.
Yeah, you're terrific, by the way, Jeff. We really like you.
How come it's not moving?
Will you just wait? Jeez. He's going to hit his camera, and then the picture will come in, and then you'll see Jeff.
Hi, Jeff.
There. Oh, he hung up.
He didn't take a request.
Oh, here we go. He's coming back in again, hopefully.
He has a nice smile.
Yeah, nice guy. Anyway, so all I'm saying is that, you know, you get these this whole idea of taking requests I thought was bogus. And so that's
I used to get yelled at all the time.
I liked it when I was a teenager because every once in a while I'd hear myself on the radio requesting and dedicating a song.
Yeah. I used to get yelled at because I'd play songs that I wasn't supposed to play.
Really?
Yeah. I was like, it's Saturday night, you know, oldies party or all requests Saturday night or whatever the station was. And I'm like, come on. Really, we're not going to play. You know, I got yelled at for playing Main Street by Bob Seger. I'm like, why can't I play Main Street?
Yeah.
Stick to the list.
Yeah. But still, you've told people call in with requests, right?
Yeah. That's, yeah.
Hey, you know, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jason.
I was just a real quickie, too. Is Bob Seger as big around the country as he is here?
I don't know if he is there.
He's pretty big, but, you know, just very classic, you know, rock and roll guy, you know.
I think it's changed a lot from when Bob Seger was popular. When I lived in Florida in 1979, to me, you know, I was in Central Florida, and huge band, Van Halen, REO Speedwagon. When I moved back up to New York in 1979, nobody heard of REO Speedwagon. So it was more regional then. But I think now it's satellite radio, internet.
Yeah. Who's the Rod Stewart and Bob Seger? Who's bigger?
In New York, it would be Rod Stewart.
Who was the folk singer? I think his name was Seger. He used to sail his boat up and down the Hudson River. Pete Seger. Okay. He died a couple years ago.
Well, I think you're really far afield there. Pete Seger and Bob Seger. Yeah, Bob Seger was Pete Seger's son.
Was he?
No.
Okay. Well, I remember Pete Seeger. He used to sail up the river, and you could hear them playing their music on their boat when I was at the yacht club. You know, and they would go past Montrose. But, you know, if you're serious about wanting to do an online course for broadcasting, you know, I have that customer of mine.
By the way, we've been joined by Vernon Nunn. Hello, Vernon.
Marty. Hello. Gonzalez. Marty Gonzalez is the head of the broadcasting department at what's the university you went to in San Francisco State?
Yeah.
You know, I can call him and put you guys together if you want.
We're going to fly out to California every other day.
Oh, you said you would do it online.
You mean a teaching?
No,
teaching?
I'm thinking of creating a course online.
Okay. I understand, but if you want, you know, by doing it through
San Francisco State. Why do I need to do it through San Francisco State?
They list it in their book and they give credits.
No, I don't want it to be something that we give credit for.
What's your idea? I didn't hear this.
Everyone. What?
What's your idea? I didn't hear this.
I mentioned this to girlfriend during the opening of the show that I'm trying to figure out what to do after I'm through with Life in the Passing Lane because it's got about maybe 10 more episodes before my life is over. maybe more, maybe 15, but what do I do after that? And I came up with the idea of maybe doing a broadcasting school. Can you hear me now, Jeff?
Now we're on.
Okay, now get your camera going so we can see your lovely punim, and we'll be kicking ass and taking names. By the way, we have Jason with us, Rob Alfano, Jeff Stein, Phil Meyer, Scott Boddicker, and Vernon Nunn, who, by the way, can just rap out some mean Morse code.
Right. So, and we have room for three more.
And we have room for three more, says our census taker.
A counter, yeah.
But where were we? Oh.
You were talking to Rob about online course.
I just wanted, you know, maybe a course, you know. Here are my theories on how you do radio. And, you know, give that a try. You know, I don't know. It's just in the works. I haven't figured it out yet.
You could go to Trump University and teach it.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. By the way, Jeff.
Yeah.
Have you turned on your camera?
Just good. I did, but.
You click your thing that says where the camera is. And
you know, Scott, he can't go to Trump University because they got to have courses where you can actually teach somebody to make money at Trump University. This was how not to make money in broadcasting.
Yeah. Jason?
I thought it was kind of funny, even though it took Trump, brought the little tiny village that I grew up in into the national spotlight today.
Which little village was that?
He was in Diamonddale, Michigan. It's a little tiny village in Michigan, just a little farming community, where he was talking about trying to get the black vote, which was kind of funny because Diamonddale's 93% white.
Okay, let me just talk to Jeff a second. Jeff, sometimes when you go to turn on your camera, it looks like it disconnects you or something.
Yeah, something's going wrong.
Do you have a picture of a camera there?
That's what I'm looking at. I'm seeing you.
Yeah, but if you put your cursor over the thing, it should come up at the bottom. You should have like a camera, and you should have a
microphone.
The microphone and a plus sign and a.
What's the plus sign do?
That adds somebody.
Oh, okay.
So what's
the you do that?
I never use it.
Oh,
it's one that looks like a telephone, or no, like
yeah, that there's one there that looks like a telephone. That's to turn it off. Don't.
What is he calling in on?
Don't touch that. What are you using? A PC or a
Mac?
Or a Mac? Jeff, are you there, Jeff? Uh oh. I think he hit the red button.
Yeah, it's at the red button. No.
Now push the red button.
Yeah, that's Jeff, the blow up button.
Are you there, Jeff? Can you hear me? Whoops. Well, we have Mark Green just signed on, so he should be joining us.
Mark.
Yeah. But anyway, so you know, it's just an idea in the works. I don't know. I may never do it, but it came from somebody who told me that I should teach a course at a college on how to interview, and. That it could also apply to people who just, you know, want to work in business and interview people for jobs and things like that, you know, and the art of the interview. But I haven't, you know, that didn't appeal to me for some odd reason, yeah. You know.
You know, Marty is not only the head of the broadcasting department at San Francisco State, he's the weekend anchor for KRON TV News.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so.
Well, you know, just in case you want to talk.
He's the head of the broadcasting department there, and I probably know more about broadcasting than he does.
Well, he's been around a while.
What's a while?
Maybe 30 years.
Oh, that's a kid. That's a kid. I've been doing this for over 60 years.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I know. Before Marconi invented the television.
Yeah.
Carney invented the radio.
Jeff, are you there?
Marconi didn't invent the television.
Oh, which he was the radio. Who invented? Who is the guy that invented the TV?
Tesla invented the radio.
Huh?
I said Tesla invented the radio.
No, actually, the radio. No, wait a minute. You're getting all your things mixed up. Tesla was involved in the invention of electricity.
No, if you look back at the patents that Tesla had, actually Tesla invented the radio.
Well, there's a
the guy who starts with a Z.
Well. There, TV, for instance, yep. Was invented in either by.
There were two different methods of television, and Sarnoff, right?
What was his name? Man, I am so tired tonight. I can't remember names tonight. There was a guy in San Francisco who invented TV first, but he never got credit for it because Sarnoff came along and tried to say that it was RCA.
But Farnsworth.
Farnsworth, Hello. Philo T. Farnsworth, right.
Right.
And he did it in about 1920 in San Francisco. And eventually, a few years ago, he was officially credited with being the inventor of television.
Yeah, but who's Charles Francis Jenkins?
I don't know.
It said that he's also the inventor of television.
Hmm. Well, anyway, radio was Marconi.
Oh, I think it was just recently it was re-awarded to Tesla because with his he wanted to do the wireless electricity, and that was actually for broadcast purposes. And then the person who invented radio or whatever, they ended up re-awarding it to Tesla for his long-range communication or whatever he was trying to do with the wireless electricity.
Really?
And Tesla.
Go ahead.
I thought Tesla died broke.
A lot of them died broke. Farnsworth was literally the inventor of television. What happened was, as a kid, he came up with the idea of television because he was working the family farm and creating furrows. And then suddenly started to think, what if I were to take a tube of some sort, maybe it'll etch a picture across it, like the furrows in a field. And he applied that years later to his his little company that he started in San Francisco and came out with the first practical television picture.
I'm looking in the... And they said that this guy, Vladimir Zworykin.
Yeah, he invented the tube.
The ionoscope.
The ionoscope, yeah. But that was part of the patent that had to do with Sarnoff, who was a bloody fucking thief, okay, and would steal stuff. In fact, Edison stole, too. Edison stole movies. He didn't invent motion pictures. Was invented by William Freeze Green, a British guy.
It was a porno company, the first movie, right?
No. No. But I think that was the second movie.
The second movie.
Yeah. I don't think Edison really invented anything. He just took credit for the people he had working for him that invented stuff.
Hello to Mark Green. Are you there, Mark?
I'm here.
We're just waiting for your picture to pop in, which could pop in at any minute. There we go. And Jeff, are you there?
I'm not so sure.
Oh, no, you are there. We can hear you. Don't worry. Yeah. If we can't see you, doesn't matter. Just join in anytime you want to say something, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Just don't raise your hand.
Just wanted to make sure you were there.
Raise both hands.
How are you tonight, Jeff?
I'm pretty good.
God, you know, you've been a new source of new blood to this show.
We need it.
And very intelligently so. So I want to just thank you for calling and urge you to continue doing it. Mark, how are you this evening?
I'm good, and Jeff smiles an awful lot.
Yes, he has a frozen smile right now. Yeah. How does everybody feel about the fact that, let's see here, Trump just lost his head of his campaign that was demoted or something?
He resigned.
And now he quit Manafort.
Wasn't he being investigated for some dealings in the Ukraine?
No, he wasn't being investigated for that. Oh, yes, he was just being accused of it.
He felt he was a distraction.
Yeah.
So, I think he's being investigated, but wasn't it also something to do with the same firm that this guy is the brother of Hillary Clinton's campaign manager?
Say that again.
Hillary Clinton's campaign manager's brother owns another campaigning firm who I think this guy that Trump was involved with is part of. All these freaking people, not to sound like Phil, but man, it's a whole trilateral commission type of conspiracy. These campaign managers are all fucking related, and then they're campaigning for all these other people in these other countries and shit too.
Yeah.
Bad.
Yeah. But, you know, I think this looked mixed. People haven't picked up on this yet, but I think this makes Trump look bad. Because if the way he's going to run his administration is the same way he's running this campaign, he's going to keep firing people every week.
You mean the same
way? You're fired!
Well, he thinks it's a reality show.
You mean this? Well, no, he didn't fire the guy. The guy resigned on his own.
Well, yeah, he resigned because he didn't want to be a distraction.
Well, yeah, he was.
Rather
I mean,
than having
I think
Trump saying you're fired, he did that. Okay.
He wanted to spend more time with his family.
Yeah, he wanted to spend more time with his family. That's what they always say.
He's a real professional.
He fell on his sword. You know, it's really what happened.
Did you hear about this new woman who's working for Trump now?
Yeah, I'm pretty familiar with her because I've seen her a lot on the talk shows. And I always kept going, I kept saying to myself, oh, it's that cunt again.
She's a pollster, a Republican pollster.
Yeah. She has the poll? She's on the poll? What?
Yeah. That
she's a pole dancer.
Pole dancer. Oh, okay.
If you saw her, you wouldn't look at the pole. You know, it's just...
Yo, the pole's better looking. Yeah. Okay.
Jeff, how do you take this whole getting rid of people and picking up people and so on? I
think Trump's toast. I can't even think about him as being anybody realistic at this point. I think his numbers are so bad. He changes his mind every day. I think a lot of the people who supported him for a long time are just either hiding or getting or officially saying, I'm no longer talking to this guy. I'm no longer supporting him.
Hey, Jeff, he's lost those.
It's a good train.
those 75 insiders that happened to be in the Republican Party. I don't think he, you know, really had those guys to begin with. And, you know, those were those anybody
well,
but Trump.
Well, he needed them. And he's finding that out now. Jason, you have your hand.
So, and I'm still like a week or a week and a half behind in listening to your show. And Phil was talking about in one of the latter episodes I listened to how you're kind of be starting on the fence about Trump. And you said you were going to give him a week or two.
Right.
So are you still on your point where you're giving him a week or two, or are you?
So far, you see, I think that he's coming around.
Now that he's becoming an apologist?
Well, not really.
What do you mean, not really? I apologize.
He's reached out to black people. Not that that's going to get him any black votes, but he has. He's not doing the kinds of things he was doing in the last week.
So he's not being authentic anymore.
He's not being a sellout.
He's a combination of authentic and
he's an authentic sellout.
No. Today, when he said to the black audience, well, not audience, but the black
in Diamonddale, where I grew up, that was 93% white. You know, the 7% was my family that was Mexican, and we moved out.
So what he said is, you know, what do you got to lose? I mean, those were ad lib statements that he made during a teleprompter type on target speech. And so he's starting to mix in his own tone.
You are just, you know, something. Somebody once told me something, Phil, and you should take this advice to heart. There are a lot of things you can do in life, but the one thing you'll never be able to do is shine shit.
Well,
and you're right now. You are shining shit.
I sent you the email that I was sent, so you can maybe with $49 get a gold Trump card.
Yeah.
did you read that donation thing?
I saw that thing, and I'm sorry, I'm not signing up.
You're not? Okay.
Yeah.
I don't think Trump wants you anyway. He'd fire you.
Yeah, right. And Trump needs me. Nobody gets to the White House without my approval.
Well, that's
true.
You
know that, don't you?
Yeah. Have you applied to the Trump Broadcasting Network?
Well, you claim that's what the next thing he's going to start if it doesn't work out.
Yeah, Michael Moore started that rumor.
Really?
Yeah, he wrote an article about all of this is I guess his conspiracy theory that Donald Trump didn't intend to win in the first place, and once he got this far, he starts bringing in all these media people because he's going to start his own network.
Yeah, with Ailes.
It surprised me.
Yeah. Well, Ailes is a has-been.
And then once he gets Carpet One to put in some new carpet, he's going to apply for bankruptcy.
By the way, it's interesting to note that Fox has been firing a lot of Ailes people.
Really?
Or they're resigning, or, you know, there's...
He had people...
About three of them so far have been...
He kept people there to keep them silent because they had non-disclosure things, and he was paying a couple of people some very big money, but they didn't do much of anything. And so what happened was the two sons, Murdoch's sons, found out about these guys, started saying, what do you do? What do you do? And then they found out that these guys don't do anything except collect a high salary, and it was Ailes buying their silence.
Where did you hear that one?
NPR, they have these podcasts.
Oh,
and,
yeah, I believe podcasts.
Well, no, but this one was, I'll look at it, I'll look it, I get it.
It must be true, because I heard it on the podcast.
And by the way, where they're full of shit is, if you sign a non-disclosure agreement, that follows you after the job, too.
Well, I understand. It wasn't necessarily a non-disclosure agreement. It was more a contract that kept them silent while they were under the employ of Fox.
Silent about what?
About Ailes and his
sexual capabilities.
Let me go, and I'll find the
podcast.
I wonder what O'Reilly had to do.
It's called Fresh Air.
Yeah.
And is the show
Fresh Air.
Is the NPR podcast. But let me find.
It's not an NPR podcast. It's a broadcast.
No, this is a podcast.
No, Fresh Air isn't a podcast.
No? Well, these, okay. Well, then it's a broadcast.
Everybody, you have a drink.
Yeah.
Everybody have a drink. Phil fucked up again. Yeah, go ahead, Scott. Hi, Scott. We haven't even heard from you tonight. You just kind of silently crawl in here.
Yeah. You got a good crowd. I'll be quiet.
Well, no, you know, I like it when you get it. Are you drinking tonight?
I'm starting.
I like it when you get a little.
Have a drink with me, Scott.
I like it when you get a little in your cups because you get really rowdy.
Look at that.
Hey, Paps. PBR, right? It was called The Rise and Fall of Fox News CEO Roger Ailes, and it was done by Gabriel Sherman, who is a journalist, let's see.
Can wait.
Yeah, well, that's basically it. It was a very interesting broadcast that I listened to in a post-recorded state.
Post-recorded state, yeah, which would be probably Nevada. Mark, all these comings and goings of these people in Trump's campaign, do you have any opinion about that?
Yeah, I mean, the obvious one is, like, why does it happen so often?
You know, this is the, what, this is the third, let's see here.
Yeah, he had that Corey Lewandowski guy who roughed up the Breitbart girl reporter. Yeah.
It's interesting that the Breitbart guy.
And then he hired the Russian oligarch lobbyist, you know.
There's a lot of people saying that Breitbart, while I didn't pay a lot of attention to Breitbart because I quite frankly don't want to read slanted journalism, was also homophobic and racist.
I don't know if Andrew Breitbart was. But this guy, Steve Bannon, who was now the head of Breitbart, Andrew Breitbart died unexpectedly.
Yeah.
A year ago.
Probably was killed by Steve.
Possibly. I don't know. But anyway, Breitbart was he's out there a little bit, but this Bannon guy who took his place is white racist supremacist. He is anti-Jewish.
Well, so am I, but that doesn't matter.
No, but I mean in a bad way, not in a good way, not in a friendly way.
He knows how to attack, though. He knows how to attack.
So why if Donald Trump is so bright, would he choose all these bad people? That would be the question I'd
probably. I don't know that the guy that he chose is bad for his campaign. You know?
Go to Breitbart's site, Phil.
How do you feel about the fact that a man who has been called a racist and homophobic, by people who've read what he writes and here's what he says, okay?
All right.
That Trump is embracing this guy. Yeah. I'd rather have the guy that was friends with Putin, for crying out loud.
Well, I'll go to Snopes and I'll ask the question, is Bannon a racist?
Bannon. Boy.
Bannon was from the
Phil.
Joe.
What?
Look at Phil being following the John Birch Society. How did that shit all start? Anti-Semitic, racist, everything.
He loves the John Birch Society, Phil, but doesn't realize JBS was entirely anti-Semitic. Just raging.
Made with good reason.
Ragingly anti-Semitic.
Damn those Jews. Let's put them in gas chambers and burn them.
Hey, if you're a Jew and you can't stand Jews, I understand it. But if you're a goyim like he is, you know. Jeff, with a name like Stein, it's obvious that you're one of the Klan here.
That's true.
Does it ever bother you when you hear that somebody says that somebody is anti-Semitic?
Not as much as it used to. I think after a number of years, it's less of an issue. I mean, look at the fact that Bernie was potentially going to be the first Jewish president.
Yeah.
And nobody seemed to say anything about that.
That's true. His religion didn't come up.
Because he's an atheist.
Well, I know he is, but most people don't know that.
That was another reason I voted for him.
What's interesting, I think Jeff would agree with me, I'm an atheist. but I'm Jewish. And I will never deny that I'm Jewish. And there is room, being a Jew, to be an atheist.
Yeah, because it's about the culture more than the...
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, it's more than just being like, if you're Catholic, it's not being part of a tribe. Right. You know? Whereas if you're Jewish, you have a history behind you as well. And it doesn't say that you have to practice the religion to be Jewish. Does that make sense? Would you agree with me, Jeff?
I don't get it. To me, it is, because I know many people in my family feel exactly the same as you do.
And how do you feel about it? Same thing?
Pretty much. And you know, but I don't really put a hard line either way. You know, I know there's other people who are very interested in Judaism, and so I would go to synagogues with them because whatever, they're my granddaughter's getting bat mitzvah or something like that.
Yeah,
which is, you know, more of a social
exactly
growth rather than a religious change. Even though if my granddaughter becomes very, very religious, that's fine too. I think that's an okay thing.
Well, I mean, I think that's an option people have. The reason I become an atheist is because I looked at the world around me and I saw what religion was doing to the world around us. And I just didn't believe that a belief in God is something that I wanted to get on board with. Let me see. Who had his hand up first? Let's go to Mark first. Okay, Jason, and
yeah,
then you.
I just have a quick comment, Jason, that Bernie to me was a politician who happened to be Jewish. Like, you could be a politician who happened to have brown hair. Right. It was not like the focal point of who are you, who he was.
Was Obama a politician who happened to be black?
Yeah.
Okay.
I would say yes. I mean, there were people initially, Alex, who questioned whether he was actually black enough.
Is Hillary how do you classify her? Is she a politician?
She's not black.
Who happens to be a woman? She's not black.
No. I'm not a Hillary fan. I'm a Democrat. I'm a left winger. But I'm not a Hillary fan, and I think she is just a talented, aggressive person who got here because a lack of competition.
Yeah.
But she's not stupid. That my argument against I would rather have the Republican argument against Hillary is she'll wreck the Supreme Court. I would rather have a bad Supreme Court than a nuclear war. You know, give me that choice. I'll take her every day.
Yeah. Jason.
So I guess I'm kind of lost track where I was going to go with it, but what was your ancestry from Europe?
Mine?
Yeah. So Phil, you're Russian, right?
Yeah, well, I'm Russian.
Or you're Russian.
I'm Russian, and then my parents, my father was born in Germany. But of Russian parents. I think what we call ourselves is Ashkenazi Jews.
Yeah.
Because, see, and that's my whole thing is, like, you know, if you were to test your DNA, you know, what are you? You're European, more than likely, correct?
Yeah.
So I don't understand the whole religious. My ancestry comes from Poland or something.
Wouldn't Russian, though, be Slavic?
I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, that's where I get my confusion from, where somebody says that they're an atheist, but they still claim this religious thing that started over in the Middle East, where you're obviously not Middle Eastern because you're whiter than I am. And, you know, so that's my confusion.
As a Jew, I've always felt kind of conflicted, okay? Because people say, well, what is it? Is it a religion or what is it? Well, it's several things, and none of which is exclusive to the from the other. It's a religion, yes, but it is also a culture, and it is also a birthright.
But it's more, I almost more feel that it seems like people who are Jewish say that it's more of an ethnicity.
Let me put it this way. There's the ethnic component, but then there's the religious component that goes along with the ethnicity. It's much like a good example would be Muslims. Same thing, you know. I mean, I'm Arabian, but I'm also a Muslim, you know.
But Jews are not a Jews are a religion, and they were all over the world. There are black Jews from Ethiopia. There are Chinese Jews.
I don't think the only component of being Jewish is the religion. It's also the ethnicity.
But you guys are not ethnic Jews.
I don't think there is an ethnicity if you're.
They would look the same as the.
Well, I'm
the
proud
Muslims.
To be a Jew, but I'm also proud to be an atheist. So figure that one out.
Well, how about
and
your
the only people that confuse me about it are all the people that confuse me about it.
Can you be both?
Yes, Scott.
Absolutely.
Can you trace your Judaism back to one of the 12 tribes of
I don't know. And
but
I'm
which,
not about
which
ready
one of the
to,
tribes
I'm
went
not,
to Russia?
I'm not
you
about
know?
Ready to send my DNA to the Mormons so that they can send me a thing and saying, here's your history.
Okay. But that's always been my big question. Did Judaism, because I know the spread of Christianity. I know how the Christianity spread. You know, the people who won the battle get to write the story or whatever. But how did Judaism spread? Did people actually from the Middle East spread out and spread the religion and, you know, commingle with the other people? Or did just the religion itself spread? Or
spread because they had to flee. They had to flee because of persecution. And that is why oftentimes Jews became doctors and lawyers and so forth, because they could take their profession with them and no matter where they were in the world, or jewelers, because of the atrocities that were committed against them over the several thousand years.
Led me to ask this question. What do we do that keeps pissing people off?
We're the chosen people.
Jews. Stop being a Jew and we won't start persecuting you.
Why don't they choose somebody else once in a while?
No, I mean, you know? All I ever read in my history was, you're a Jew, and do you know what happened in Germany? You know what happened in Egypt? And I'm starting to think, are we pissing people off?
Today, not as much as the Muslims.
Predictions. I did a little research.
Wait,
I have a little.
Hold on a second, Phil. Jeff?
Yeah, I want to say something very interesting to me. Isn't it always a real problem when you hear somebody doing something very bad, they get arrested or they murdered somebody, and the person has a quasi-Jewish last name?
Yeah.
Don't you think about that? And you go, oh my God, because this is going to somehow represent me.
Yeah.
And I didn't have anything to do with it, but
I think it's more of when they're stealing money. That's when you might feel more offense.
Adolf? Is he Jewish?
What?
Bernie Madoff? Was Bernie Madoff a Jew?
Yeah.
Yes, unfortunately.
Ah!
Unfortunately.
Bingo!
And I've been watching a documentary. I haven't finished watching it yet, so no spoilers. Don't tell me how it turns out. About Leopold and Loeb. These two kids who decided to be fun to murder somebody.
Mm-hmm.
So they went and murdered a kid named Bobby Franks, who they knew was close to the family. They had told him they'd give him a ride home, and then they choked him to death and then dumped his body in a drainage pipe. And they wanted to see if they could get away with murder. And the parents were millionaires. In those days, being a millionaire, they hired Clarence Darrow to defend them. And all I could think was, and we wonder where anti-Semitism comes from, you know. Leopold and Loeb.
It seems that Trump was accused of being anti-Semitic when he told the Republican Jewish Coalition in December, I'm a negotiator like you folks. So it's, you know, you people.
There we go again.
Yeah.
But I just think it's, you know, and this whole notion about the Supreme Court, you know, Hillary's going to be able to pick the Supreme Court, but she's going to have to go through Congress to do it, just like Obama had to go through Congress to do it. And I'm telling you right now, the Republicans, if they were smart, would pick up on the current nominee from Obama. I can't remember his name right now, because this guy is so middle down the middle of the road that he's going to look like a walk in the park compared to who she picks.
That's right.
And he's a Republican.
He's supposedly a very good choice. He's a great jurist. But they won't even talk to him. And they're going to be very disappointed if they're making a big gamble here. You know, that Hillary's not going to be president, because if she is, I don't know who she's going to put in the Supreme Court, but it's not going to be their idea of a good time.
See, well, I don't know. I kind of worry about who she would put too, because as pro business as she is, it'd be somebody who would bought off, pay to play.
Yeah. Judge Merrick Garland.
Merrick Garland. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. That's the guy. And I mean, they should be hoping and praying that, you know, they should try and pass him immediately, because they don't know he's going to come down in the middle somewhere. And as much as they say they don't want the court legislating from the bench, they'd love to have the court legislating from the bench if it were tipped over to the conservative side. But if you had a total of seven in the Supreme Court? Nine.
Nine.
If you had
nine.
If you had it four and four and then somebody in the middle, well, sometimes they'll swing one way, sometimes they'll swing the other way.
Well, that's why Kennedy is
that.
Now.
They don't want that. They want something. You know, they want them. They want somebody who's going to hew the conservative line. And I, you know, and then they at the same time they say we don't want a court that legislates from the bench. Bull fucking shit.
I have a little point of interest here.
Okay.
And that is because the Republicans now control the Senate, and their responsibility, according to the way the concept is set up, is that they have to either say yay or no mm-hmm. on any new guy. But at this point, they haven't done it. So I would think that Obama could go to the court and ask the court to say they have to yay or nay.
You know something? I don't know if he could do that. Wouldn't that be a conflict of interest asking the very body who is going to be affected by a decision to make a decision?
I think part of the judge's responsibility is often to make final decisions, or as it goes to how the Senate and the president and whatever, how they operate according to the law.
Yeah.
Now, the part is, does the law really say anything about that? Everybody kind of says no. But, you know, there's a good way that judges can make decisions, even though it's not written on a piece of paper yet.
Yeah.
And if this thing goes on and on and on, that's going to be very, very interesting.
Well, what the Congress has been saying is, oh, you can't appoint somebody during your last year in office.
That's total bullshit.
There's no law about that. Somebody said that once that they felt that maybe it was inappropriate to do, but there's no law against it. And what do you say, that a president in his last term has no ability to legislate?
Yeah, why is that inappropriate? Why would that even be at all inappropriate?
Well, that's what they're saying.
Jason. Well, that's what Mitch McConnell is saying in the Senate. He's saying they have to go back 80 years before that was ever done. But he's totally ignoring Anthony Kennedy, yes. who was appointed in the last year of Ronald Reagan's
term. Well, they're saying something about because Biden did the same thing when he was in the Senate.
It was Biden who said it.
Hold on, because there was different circumstances then. It wasn't that somebody died. It was that somebody wanted to retire, and they wanted to say, I want to hurry up and retire and get out of here so you can appoint somebody so I don't wait until next year if somebody else gets elected. Right. That's that was trying to game the system, and there's a little bit of difference when somebody dies.
It wasn't a rule, Phil.
Yes, it's called Biden rule.
No, he didn't pass. In order for something to be a rule, there has to be something codified in the law.
Okay, now it's called the Biden rule.
So-called Biden rule in reference to Biden's comments in 1992.
Yes, but that doesn't make it a rule.
Not to nominate a Supreme Court justice in an election year.
That is not a...
That was because that Supreme Court justice wanted to retire.
Yeah, but that's...
And it was a Republican Supreme Court justice.
What did you say, Scott?
It was really late in the session, too. They wanted to do it like in August or September of the year, not in... You know, of course, where do you draw the line? It doesn't matter. You know, whether it's August, September, January.
The guy is president of the United States. He should be allowed to do his duties until the very end.
Yep. That's right.
I agree.
It's one thing the guy died, but I agree, though, that I don't like the idea that, well, I'm a Democratic justice and I want to step down. I've got a few more months of Obama, so I'm going to resign now. So the guy, that's wrong. I don't like that.
But, you know what? Biden was talking about George Bush in 92. It wasn't Reagan.
Yeah, no, it doesn't matter what Biden said. It's not a law. It's not a rule.
They go by precedents, though, usually in the Senate,
Alex. There was no precedent. It was his own opinion.
They want to say that there's precedent, though. That's what McConnell's whole argument is the precedent is already established and that's what you don't do that.
They're saying that's precedent, but it's two separate issues. Somebody wanting to retire at the last, you know, at the end of somebody's term versus somebody died.
Right.
Didn't know that Donald should be retired.
You know, I mean, I think it's very rude on the part of the Senate to do that. It's rude to what's his name? Merrick Garland.
Merrick Garland.
And it's rude to the president and it's rude to the American people. We need a full Supreme Court and we're not being allowed to have it because Mitch McConnell says we're not even going to listen to Merrick Garland. And there are a lot of people, a lot of even Republicans who said they met up with Merrick Garland, and he's just fine. He's terrific. You know, it would do the Republicans a lot of good to pass Merrick Garland. It's the best bet they're going to get, unless Trump becomes president, and don't hold your fucking breath. You know?
Well, you know, the Democrats are peppering Trump with all of this bigotry, homophobic, and anti-Semitic comments, but it's really them that's the Democrats that are peppering him with these comments. If you look at his supporters,
with what comments?
You know, they're trying to paint him to be unprepared.
Nobody's painting him to be anything. He's showing it.
They're using certain statements to try to say he's showing it, and I believe that they're trying to direct a course of attack against
it's
him.
It's called an election year, Phil, and you point out a person's weak spots, and I got to tell you, he is one of the most unprepared people to be president that's ever existed.
His own party is against him.
That's because he's fighting the insiders.
You're doing. You're eating the bullshit that he's going to be using as his excuse when he loses.
He's been setting up
this whole thing from the very beginning for what will happen if he loses. And if he loses, he can say, "I was saying all along that this was fixed, and now I've proved it. I didn't win, therefore it's fixed." Oh, yeah, only a third of the country voted for me, but it's still fixed.
It's fixed. You know, look at the DNC and what they did to Bernie Sanders. The whole thing is fixed. And you got blinders on.
Oh, so I should vote for Trump because that's gonna take the blinders off?
No, because he's not going to kowtow to those insiders that have been running things.
You have to put blinders on to vote for Trump, but the other problem is if you voted for him with the blinders on, you'd have to hold your nose at the same time, and that's quite a hat trick.
I understand where you're coming from, Phil, but do you really trust this guy who says the kinds of things he says? But, I mean, at least she's proven public service.
Oh, wait a minute. Let me also point something else out here, Phil.
Yeah.
He keeps saying, oh, you know, he's acting like the outsider. What outsider? He's a fucking multi-billionaire. That's as inside as you get in this country.
It's the only way you can fight these guys.
He didn't ever become a billionaire to fight these guys. He became a billionaire because he wanted the money.
You know, I think he became a billionaire because he was just smart enough to invest in New York real estate.
Listen, and to screw the small guy. That's how he got rich. You know,
yeah, and not pay guys who put down carpet in his casinos.
I wish I put it down before the bankruptcy and got paid in 30 days. But, you know, the thing is, you look at, you know, what he did early on. He believed in New York real estate. Hey, if I had the balls to do a tenth of what he did, I'd be a wealthy guy.
He wasn't a terrible success at all of this.
$1 million to start.
He had $1 million to start. Yeah, I don't know how many times I had $1 million in assets and blew it, you know.
We're not talking about $100 million in assets. He had $1 million
loan.
Cash.
Yeah, well, I have blown $500,000 at one point. Actual cash where it came into me. I had it in the bank account and I lost it. So, you know, there are times, you know, I didn't have the balls to do what he did. You know, I didn't have the balls to look at real estate in the 1970s in New York and say, you know, I should buy these burned out buildings. He did. And he's a billionaire because of it.
He's a poor billionaire.
Well,
as billionaires go, he's on the low end of the spectrum.
Well, believe me, I couldn't even fill his car up with gas with the amount of money that I got. You know, he's got a big tank, but
And that $1 billion, a lot of his money was gained off of hurting other people.
Well, look, every time you make an investment, somebody wins. It's not a matter of somebody wins and somebody loses.
You're making a bunch of excuses for despicable behavior.
If you bought a house in 1970 for $25,000 and that house is worth $1 million today,
does that mean you should become president?
How do you open a fucking casino and lose money?
Everybody lost money in Atlantic City with the at that time, and also because of the hurricane.
Atlantic City, believe me, he went bankrupt with the Taj Mahal long before the hurricane.
Because you had all these other casinos opening up, Indian casinos, and all of those casinos, whether it was his or any of the others.
When he finally went bankrupt on that thing, he owed $30 million in taxes, which the government tried to get, but his pal Chris Christie bailed him out and made it so he'd only have to owe $5 million.
Well, I guess what are all these Native American casinos? What did they do that his casino didn't do?
It took people. There was no reason for people to go to Atlantic City anymore. They could go in their own backyard and gamble and get.
That's where you just have to compete. That's capitalism. Offer something that they don't offer.
You have to be a good enough billionaire to be able to fight that, but he wasn't.
Well, it's difficult to fight, you know, gambling in your own backyard in a place where Atlantic City is a pit.
Yeah, Atlantic City is far. It's a long drive. It's out of the way. Like places like Foxwoods and all those, they're way more convenient for people to get to. Yeah. So that I get, you know.
Yeah.
So he offers something they don't have.
He went into a business and didn't look at the obvious pitfalls.
No, there were no pitfalls at the time that he went into the business. These Indian casinos all of a sudden started opening.
Okay, how do you parse the idea that $30 million he got out of having to pay because he palled up to his friend Chris Christie?
I don't know if he palled up to his friend Chris Christie or it was just a law that allowed him to get out $25 million in those taxes.
He was literally ordered by the courts and forced to pay $30 million, and that got forgiven down to $5 million because Chris Christie interceded.
Yes, because of bankruptcy. You know, you can't get away with 941 taxes in bankruptcy. 941 taxes are your...
You're way out of your league now, Phil, and way out of my league. We're talking about government suing and what you can pay and what you can't pay, and if you go bankrupt, what you can do and what you can't
pay. All right. Okay, so bottom line is Atlantic City's a pit.
You know what I find despicable, Phil?
What's that?
Is your constant excuse for bad behavior.
Well, I like bad behavior, but you know, on the other hand,
the expert
Merv Griffin lost on his casino.
He didn't lose. You know, a casino he owned.
No,
the one that Trump bought.
Oh well, I thought Merv Griffin got screwed.
Well, I may have gotten screwed by Donald Trump, but I believe Merv Griffin built that place, and then Trump bought it from him, called it the Taj Mahal. And anybody want to argue with that? Anybody want to look that up and see if I'm right or wrong on this?
Looking.
So the Taj Mahal wasn't an Indian casino?
No.
No, no.
No.
Oh, yeah, that kind of thing. Yeah, they used to
actual Indian, not Native American.
Yeah.
Phil, what I find interesting, Phil, is that a lot of these Trump supporters don't want to talk about the 192 lawsuits that have been filed against Trump because of bad behavior, about screwing the small businesses that did business with him. You know, they don't want to talk about that. They want to talk about 33,000 emails that Hillary erased.
What about, I don't understand how it's not making the news now that there's a lawsuit filed against Trump for raping an underage girl.
Yeah, you're right about that. I looked it up. It does exist.
What's that?
Yes, that Trump is accused of having raped an underage girl, and the charges were filed against him, I think, and dropped.
How long ago?
This was about 20 years ago, something like that. But nobody is...
It was statutory rape, wasn't it? Basically, they were bringing these young girls around to parties that he was...
Yeah, and I think one of the women has decided to sue. And that's the suit is currently in force. Huh?
It's the October surprise.
But it's already out there on the internet. I don't understand how it's not becoming a story.
Well, here's the other thing I don't get. Hillary and her home server. All right. How was that dangerous? If in fact the CIA got hacked, the State Department servers got hacked.
Well, hers didn't.
IRS. Got hacked, and yet her server didn't. Why didn't the government go to her and find out how to build a server? You
know? Well, but that doesn't excuse it, because I've worked with federal government servers, and you know, as if you break security, you are, you know, it's illegal, right? So whether it got hacked or not, isn't the, you know, you've got so much compliance, and it's hard to believe that for all of the federal servers and stuff that I dealt with, that somebody like Hillary Clinton, nobody talks about it, or it was even allowed to happen.
But would that really have been her or people who work for her? You're that high up. You're not in charge of all that shit.
And she lied again.
I think what Hillary knows about computers, you could put in a thimble.
Oh, yeah. She had nothing to do with it.
She probably relied on other people. And they said it'd be good if he had a server at home, and then you can go through that to get your mail and so on and so forth. Other people did it. Colin Powell did it.
Right. She said Colin Powell told her to do it, and Colin Powell says, I don't recollect that.
Well,
when Colin Powell was in the State Department, they had Wang computers.
Yeah.
It was
time to do some upgrading.
Yeah, exactly.
They still have Wangs.
The thing where I think Clinton may be culpable is this whole thing with the Clinton Initiative. But my question is that going to sit badly with the American public, or are they just going to go yawn?
I think they're just going to yawn.
You think so?
Yeah.
Yeah. Jeff, how do you
think? I'm going to have to yawn.
Huh?
I'm going to have to accept her, because there's no better opportunity that's different. And I don't like what she did with the server stuff. Not physically what she did, but the fact that she talked about it 12 different ways. She kept changing the story.
The best thing she could have said was, look, I don't know much about computers, you know? I'm of an age where I'm lucky I can use a touch-tone telephone. I had other people deciding what to do, and I trusted them. Okay, if we did something wrong, then of course we did something wrong, but nothing was compromised. Nobody lost their jobs. Some people say, well, some guy may have lost his life, but they've never been able to prove that. Yes, Jason.
That's what I was just going to say. I don't know how people are sitting there saying people lost lives because of what she did.
Or they say some people could have.
Oh, I've heard people lost their lives because of what she did.
Muammar Gaddafi.
Who cares about him?
Wait a minute. How did Muammar Gaddafi lose his life?
Because if
she had something to do with his death, I'll vote for her right now.
Because it was, you know, her actions that in the State Department that allowed for the overthrow and ISIS's move into Libya.
Now, I always think that was Bob Grant.
ISIS moved into Libya after she was out of the State Department, Phil.
Yeah, plus Libya.
But if they would have had access to that email, they could have stopped them.
Right. Libya fell because of what she did, and what she did caused that regime change.
Libya fell because of what she did.
Because of the Arab Spring.
Libya fell because
there was a thing called the Arab Spring, and Gaddafi got, welled up in that and got killed as a result of that.
And because we were bombing and helping
had anything to do with that.
Yeah.
You keep looking for stuff on the internet, and you know something? You can look for anything you want to on the internet and find something that justifies your wrong beliefs.
No. What I'm looking for
is I'm going to tell you a little
and the deal between Merv Griffin and Donald Trump. That's what I'm reading about.
Well, why don't you let Scott do it? Because Scott's very good at being our.
All right.
Our researcher. Yeah. your mic isn't on, Scott. Your mic isn't on.
That'll help.
Yeah.
Griffin bought a casino from Trump.
Uh-huh.
And it was very unsuccessful, and Griffin ended up going bankrupt.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And he bought another one from him in the Bahamas, and he lost a lot of money on it, like about 300 million.
Okay. I make my case that even Griffin couldn't keep a casino up and running in these times.
Yeah, but he can buy a vowel. what I was going to say was, wait a minute, now I forgot what I was going to say.
Because I was right.
good. Okay, we'll chalk that up. One for you.
Yeah. Want to go back to Tesla?
2,000 for us. What?
Want to go back and talk about Tesla?
Yeah.
Only if you have Morse code.
I just feel that we, we're in a strange situation here. I was talking with Will Durst the other day, and we were discussing the fact about, isn't this the weirdest thing you've ever seen? And we were talking about some of the other weird things that have happened. I mean, the whole Gore thing, you know, with the Supreme Court was certainly weird. We didn't have a president till almost the beginning of the year, or a president-elect till the beginning of the year. That was kind of weird. But, you know, this has got to be the weirdest thing ever. And I think the worst choice we've been given ever since in my lifetime.
And you think Al Gore would have been a better choice?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
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 No question about it.
He knew math.
Yeah, exactly.
Fuzzy math.
Huh?
Fuzzy math.
Fuzzy math. Yeah.
No, I'll tell you, the fuzzy math, Phil, is the Republicans thinking that they can scream and holler about the deficit when they don't have control of all three branches of the government. And yet, when they do have all three branches of the government under their thumb, they spend like drunken sailors. That's called the two Santa Claus.
Two Santa Claus.
Yeah, I have to agree with you in the fact that Bush was told by a friend of mine, Dr. Larry Lindsay, that when he was his senior economic advisor, and O'Neill was the Treasury Secretary, they worked together. They both resigned at the same time. But what happened was he told Bush that the war in Iraq was going to cost three times more than he said it was going to cost.
Wait,
Jack's mic's too hot.
Jack, your mic is too hot. You're making a lot of noise.
You might have the
auto on.
He didn't get a clip.
I'm gonna get.
Now.
Okay.
Now we're having some slapback.
Jack, mute yourself. Jack.
We can't have you on tonight because
feedback.
We're having too much trouble with your signal.
It's too bad we got nine now.
Let me turn that down there.
Well, make sure you turn those things down.
Yeah.
In Skype, you might have an auto sensor on your mic.
I think he's got it fixed now.
On Skype, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway.
What I find so funny is you guys are talking about millionaires and billionaires when we've got people right now, 9 years practically after the recovery, who are still trying to scrap by on having two and three jobs. There was a story that
The recovery was false.
Oh. Says who? Didn't we have somebody say that the other day?
Who says it was false? You?
Yeah, because what we recovered in jobs was $9 an hour jobs at Walmart. We didn't get the jobs that we had 10 years ago.
Yeah, and you know why?
Those jobs you're talking about were gone 20 years ago.
Yeah. The world is changing, and you have to keep up. If you bring factories and manufacturing back to the U.S., you're not going to have the jobs you had.
You'll still get some jobs, not as many.
Everything is computerized, and those jobs are gone.
Things can be robotics and computerized. Yeah,
they're gone. You got to come up with.
But when you open up these trade agreements and make it so much easier to ship these jobs out, then you're just getting. I've done plenty of jobs where I've gone into a factory where I'm installing an alarm system, you know, line for people who. The last employees are there disassembling the equipment to ship over to China for these people to do their job.
That's what the TTP and NAFTA and all
exactly.
the trade agreements have done. And that's what Trump doesn't want and Hillary
except for every single product that Trump has is made overseas. And then even the buildings that he makes in the United States, he hires in foreign labor to come build the buildings.
You see this Trump?
The one thing.
Yeah, now he's making him in the USA because he could get caught for that. But his ties were made in Taiwan.
In China.
His suits were being made in China.
It's only reasonable that you'd get a tie from Taiwan.
Yeah, but anyway, Jack.
Hey, look. That's actually good.
Look. Now, I'm going to bring up something to kind of put this thing in perspective, maybe. The hot new Buick. Remember when Buicks were made in Flint, Michigan, where they got a water problem now?
Yeah.
In Lansing. I'm from Michigan.
Oh, well, good. The hot new Buick convertible that every gearhead like myself is talking about is made in China.
Was that the Regatta?
Which
no,
one?
It's I can't think of the name. It begins with a C. But if you go to any of the automobile fan magazines, they're talking about this car, and it's made in China.
Cassada, yeah.
Yeah,
Cassada.
Jack, there was you had one show where you were talking about where different vehicles were made, and you're even talking about the Dodge Ram. Dodge Ram's made in Warren, Michigan. You know, just down the street from me. There's a lot of vehicles.
The pickups that we get here in Texas are made across the border in Mexico.
I don't know if they have two plants, but I know they have a plant right in Warren, Michigan,
where I
work every day.
I got a bill in my pocket that says that's right.
Well. I know that I go to this plant almost, you know, weekly where they built the
I have $20 in my pocket that says the next thing that Phil Meyer says will be wrong. So anyway.
Do the plants smell like new cars?
What?
No. And then the Dodge Avenger that I also own was made in Sterling Heights, Michigan. You know, just down the street from me in the same county. Both vehicles are made in the same county.
The Ford Crown Victoria police cars were made in Canada.
It's a possibility, but
well, we could argue.
I got a $20 bill in the other pocket.
You got a lot of.
How
$20
many pockets you got?
Well, according to my wife, as many as it takes right now.
Yeah, but all the trucks that Ford makes are made right here in Louisville, Kentucky.
And don't they make the Corvette in Kentucky?
Yeah, down at Bowling Green.
Bowling Green.
Yeah.
Yep. But I'm saying, look, you know. The people that pushed for the shipping of our manufacturing jobs out of this country started during the Reagan administration, We had a
Nixon.
Well, not so much that far back, but certainly the, you know, it got on the let's go full bore ahead with this, and we were even paying through the U.S. I can't think of the name of the thing. You know, Chamber of Commerce, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. The government was giving money to corporations to ship our jobs out of the country.
Tax credits.
Yeah.
Why would they want to do that? What's the incentive there?
They were being bought off. You know. Hey, you know, our politicians are like hookers on on downtown streets in America. You got some money, we'll take it.
This Rosado looks like a Hyundai. You know.
I don't give a damn what it looks like. I'm just telling you that instead of guys in Flint, Michigan, or Lansing, Michigan, where they used to make Oldsmobiles building them, they're being built in China.
Do you remember when cars were built in Flint and you couldn't drink the water in Mexico?
Good combo.
Very well put.
Hey.
But if we want to bring our jobs back, but we need to tell these corporations, fine, you ship our jobs out of the country, you take your goddamn CEOs, your goddamn CFOs, your board of directors, and your damn families and leave my country.
And that's, you're going to pay a tariff to bring anything back in.
You pay a tariff.
Hey, you're a Trump supporter at this point, and you should be if that's the way you feel.
No, I've always been
I don't believe a word that Trump says about that.
I joined my first union when I was 15 years old. I'm still paying dues into it. And I know that union jobs built America.
Wait, what union is that, Jack?
I'm still in the IBEW.
Soviet Union?
Really? I left the IBEW, withdrew from it years ago when I went to AFTRA. I would have thought you would have gotten around to AFTRA eventually.
Well, I was in AFTRA, and I get a little AFTRA pension.
Yeah, I get an AFTRA pension myself, and I also don't pay dues anymore because I have enough years in.
Scab!
I stayed at IBEW because, hey, it was the first union I ever joined, and I just never took that withdrawal card.
I'll tell you, the reason I didn't withdraw, I withdrew from it, was when I finally got to AFTRA, and I didn't need to use my IBEW card, I said, I really don't consider myself an electrical worker.
You know what?
Hey, you're a communication worker. You should belong to the CWA.
No, actually, I'm the American Federation of Television and Radio Broadcast. Artists.
Obama bailed out GM, and now they're also going to be making the Envision in China. You know, how many GM cars are they going to start building in China when we gave, when the American government, our government, bailed out the General Motors?
They gave them a loan, Phil. They didn't give money away for free, and they paid the loan back with interest.
Yes. You can make fun of that interest, Phil, but that's money that Obama made for the American public.
But you also can't isolate just one industry. That's the way of the world right now, is all this offshoring, right? That's the way of the world.
I think the best way to describe it, Rob, it's a world economy now. It's not just the United States economy.
So we'll start living like the North Vietnamese.
Let Rob finish what he was saying, Phil.
No, that was pretty much it. You know, you can't isolate business. You can't say, well, we gave them a loan and we pulled them out. How are they paying us back? If they want to remain competitive in the way the world is doing business today, this is what they have to do.
Mark, you have your hand up.
Yeah, I just have a question for Phil, obviously. Donald Trump wants to bring jobs back to America.
Yeah.
I think he believes that. Does he believe that Americans have the right to organize?
I wouldn't see why not, but I don't know.
No, it's a yes or no.
If he's against organized unions, I don't know.
He's against them because none of his casinos had unions in them.
Yeah, well, I think the reason why was that his employees were happier not with not having the unions than having the unions, because he treated them better than the unions would have treated them. And I think that's what's going on at Mar-a-Lago as well.
Well, you know, Phil,
Mar-a-Lago has.
I'll tell you, the unions. Unions
immigrants. They're not Americans.
Wait a minute. Unions are back on the rise again because, yes, there were a lot of people in the older days, especially in my business, who go, oh, we don't need a union. We'll make decent enough money here. And now they're finding out that didn't work. That everybody's trying to get away cheap now, and they want unions back in. So unions are starting to be installed back in places where they disappeared.
Good.
Yeah. And Republican-controlled state legislatures are trying to pass right-to-work laws.
Let me see. Well, I just want to find out here for a second. Hold on a second.
Vernon, here in Texas, we call them right-to-starve laws.
Yeah, hold on a second, laws. Jack. Somebody just called Ted. In on the phone, and I don't know who it is. Is it Ted?
I don't know. We got
yes,
Ted.
Yes, it is. I just want to say one thing on the GM deal. The government got shares of GM stock when they did that deal, and they sold them at a loss. So the government did lose money on the GM deal. That's it. Bye-bye, boys.
Hey, Ted.
We got a full house.
Okay, we did have a full house.
Oh, okay.
Did he hang up?
Huh?
Yeah. Did he hang up?
Yeah. I got to get everybody back in the picture here.
He's right, gone.
Ted was the guy who also said he worked for the telephone company, right?
Yeah.
So, and he said that he felt that the unions held him back from accomplishing more than we could. He was such a good communications guy. I worked for the telephone company too. This is me busting your balls, Ted, if you're still listening. You were such a good communications guy that you could have gone higher without the union, but you haven't even figured out Skype yet.
Oh!
Bingo!
Drop the mic.
Boom.
Sorry, that's a good union busting between phone guys.
Yeah. Now, my question is, you know, everybody who runs for political office says, I'm going to bring jobs back to America, and I'm going to bring jobs back. They're all lying. There's no way you're going to bring jobs back. They've left. No. They've gone.
You know, you can if you start, you know, putting in tariffs where it's going to cost you more money to build something overseas than it does here.
Ted just called back again. Yes, Ted.
Full house.
Ted. Ted.
Yeah, I couldn't. I had to respond to what he said. No, I've got Skype on my iPhone, but I was told that doesn't work, and I don't have a laptop or a desktop that I can speak.
That's a logical excuse.
And he uses a telephone because he's loyal to his past employers.
Hey, my internet signal's still going over the telephone line.
Yeah. Anyway.
CWA, baby.
Yeah. Ted, what do you do exactly, Ted?
He's retired.
I was a cable maintenance splicer when I worked for AT&T.
Oh, construction or?
Both construction and maintenance, both.
Yeah. I'm INR.
Installation
and maintenance.
In the city. I worked Chinatown. I worked, it was quite an experience. Yeah. I really enjoyed my job. In fact, I tell all the guys at work when I took a vacation that I would actually pay the company to let me drive a truck around the most beautiful city in America.
That's very.
Have you ever noticed when we only had one phone company how the goddamn phones always worked? My stuff works. We started doing all that deregulation crap.
All I know is that there was no way in the old days you could break a telephone, because if you ever got mad at your wife or something and you wanted to do something.
Western
violent.
Electric.
I tell you what, I have a company in Columbus, Ohio, and I will pay, and I will gladly accept Tez's money to drive around for me.
Well, wait a minute. Anyway, the point I'm making is you would pull the phone out of the wall, and then you would just get a screwdriver and plug it back in, or you would throw it across the room, and that damn thing wouldn't break.
Kill somebody with it.
You know, I had a phone Western for electric. Like 20 years, and you couldn't. You just there's nothing you could do to it. It just
the princess.
Break. Oh, the princess phone. Yeah. Yeah. But anyway,
you can break those. They were plastic.
They were still pretty well.
Yeah, it took a lot to break.
The only problem they had with them when they first came out is the bottom wasn't weighted. So if you tried to dial with it when it was still a dial phone, it would just skitter all over the desk.
You remember when the dials were made out of metal?
They had to put a lead weight in the bottom so that wouldn't happen. What?
The dials used to be made out of metal. Then they started making them out of plastic. It wasn't the same, you know.
It's true.
But they were cuter, the new princess phones.
That was those old Bakelite. You know, like you said, Alex, you could throw those from here in Texas to Chicago, and they would not break.
They would not break.
And the earpieces were better. The quality of the sound was excellent. You know, it's something to be said for copper.
I got to go. I got to. go do a radio show.
He's got to go do his own show. Okay.
What's your topic for tonight?
Well, let's see. We're going to hit a little bit on something you guys hit on earlier, and that is there going to be a Trump network? Which I pray there is. Serious.
And I thought the other topic is Phil wearing Tommy John's?
Well, yes, I am.
if he's going to start a broadcast network, we better start being nicer to him, Jack.
Screw him and the horse he rode in on.
anyway,
it's the plane.
Nice to the guy. I don't even want to do talk anymore.
Yeah.
I'll go back to playing schmaltzy music from the 1940s and 50s.
Yeah. Anyway, Jack, have a good show.
Same.
Bye. Okay. Let me see here. Every time I do that, I lose all my things up here for the TV. There we go. There we go. So anyway, let me see here. Remove from group. There we go. Okay. So we're left with Jason and Rob and Jeff and Mark and Phil and Scott and Vernon and Ted.
And you were worried you wouldn't have any callers.
Yeah, well, I was worried last night, too, and we had quite a few callers. We had a lot of them.
Yeah, we had a full
quality. Jeff being part of that quality, because right. Jeff's really good.
And you know the interesting thing?
Hold on a second. Let him talk. What, Jeff?
Yes, my question is that there was a guy named Jobs. I think he worked for Apple.
Yeah.
He was a billionaire.
Was
Did
he?
Anybody think that he would be capable of becoming the president?
No.
Wow.
Why? Yeah.
I just proved your crazy theory.
Yeah. Yeah, and by the way, a far more successful billionaire than Donald Trump.
Yeah.
How about Bill Gates as president? If it takes a good corporation executive to run this country, hell, he's got more money than he could actually buy up Donald Trump's portion.
Doesn't matter. He didn't stand there, go through, put down 16 guys to earn his position.
If you're using as your logic that somebody from the private sector like that would make a good president, then I suppose Steve Jobs would have made a better president.
Maybe, but I don't think that Steve Jobs had the right personality to do things. What did he do? Where is the iPod made? It's made in China. It goes against everything that Trump is trying to bring back to America.
Trump's
business. He says he is. But he's lying.
Let's be honest about something, Phil. There's no way you could make the iPod in America and sell it at the price they sold it at. And it was still very expensive item.
It costs like $20 more.
And that's what it should have done. That's what they should have done.
That's what Brazil did. Brazil actually told Apple, you want to sell your product here, you're going to make it here. Apples are made in China and in Brazil.
Okay. The other question is, and this is a hard, really hard question. In China, you can get the labor to do it. Could you find the labor to do it in America?
Yes.
You really think so? That crushing.
Importing them.
They might be Mexican, but you could find the labor.
Yeah, it could be imported.
Henry Ford was like the greatest industrialist that ever lived, and he was totally anti-Semite. Would he be a great president?
No.
Why?
President of Germany.
Well, he was a founder of a John Birch Society.
So, in other words, bottom line, Phil, and make it quick because we're almost through here. Yeah. What are Trump's qualifications?
He's the guy standing in the position to be elected or not. You know, his qualifications
what's his qualifications to be president? He is probably the most unqualified human being that ever ran.
That's possible. But what he wants,
the things that he wants to accomplish. Hey, when you hire a plumber, do you go out and say, I'm going to get a complete amateur because all the other guys have done it another way. I want the amateur to come.
I'm going to get the guy that read the book, you know. But the thing is, Trump. I would vote for him before I'd vote for Hillary.
He promised today he will never lie to us.
Right. I would rather have had someone else besides
Trump. That was a lie.
Yeah, I would really rather have had someone else besides Trump, but he's the guy that's standing there. He's what he says. I would like to see happen in this country. I would like to see the insiders not running the show anymore. And
so then why didn't you vote for Bernie Sanders?
Because I'm not a socialist either.
Well, he was talking about the same things about bringing the jobs back, you know, and, not outsourcing all that.
Also, he was also, you know, talking about
health care,
things,
education, you
know, free tuition,
Health care, education, that's
horrible things.
Like the rest of the world does, but we don't.
Then by your definition, Phil, you should have loved Obama because he was truly an outsider.
Yeah, well, you know, if you wanted to have 60 or 70% of your income as tax, then you go to Norway. I live in the United States. I want to have the choice.
Quality of living there is pretty damn good.
Yeah, and nobody seems to be complaining about the taxes. Anyway, we got to go.
It's too cold to complain
thank
there.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you, Rob. Thank you, Jeff. You know, you've been a mana from heaven, suddenly finding you and having you call the show. So keep doing it. Mark, thank you. It's always a pleasure when you call. Phil, hi. Scott. Yeah.
Oh, you don't want to kiss my ass?
No. Vernon, thank you. And Ted, thank you for joining us at this late hour. Thank you all.
Good night.
And we'll see you again on Tuesday, I guess. Okay? Bye-bye. And that's it, folks. Let me turn the camera on so you can see me full camera. I'm Alex Bennett. We'll see you again on Tuesday. Same time, same station in life. And in the meantime, as always, if you see her, tell her I love her. Okay, we've stopped the broadcast. We just keep the TV on for a few seconds to say another goodbye to the television audience. Thank you for joining us this evening. It was a full house at one point. That's terrific. Anyway, see you next Friday with the video version of The Ramble.